3, 2, 1, better algorithms to make a better tomorrow. High definition sound will be inserted in 3, 2, 1,
0 seconds. Hi everybody. This is provisory video attachment number 5 to the European format Curriculum Vitae or similar. This time I decided to show up frontally in the video because we've got some really interesting results to present today. Test of music overlay 3, 2, 1, 0. Okay. Test of screenshots. Test of direct footages from computer screen of program running. Three, two, one, go. In a video such as this one, I try to avoid as much as possible the abuse of the principle of voiceover as a strategy for creating a video, to prefer instead the frontal video approach. I mean this kind of video. The voiceover principle essentially consists in recording the speech based on a previously written text, and then to combine with it the video shots. Doing a video that way is much easier, but in my opinion, if it lasts too long, it becomes cold and dishuman. The voiceover principle, of course, persists in those situations where a figure must be shown, or a piece of source code, a formula, or of course a footage of a computer program running. I do so because I think that in this historical period of severe economical crisis and widespread social discomfort, which moreover has been going on for many years, it's particularly indicated that a video be as friendly and human as possible. especially if it's a video about something so delicate as things about searching a job, video attached to a curriculum vitae, which is obviously directly related to the fact. Test sound. 3, 2, 1, go. Sorry if sometimes I have to check out what I have to say, but that's just a little bit too much to remember. Fortunately, there is a lot to say, in fact. This is a quick provisory video to illustrate the practically definitive version of the terrain or surface rendering algorithm which I have developed. A short footage of it in action could be seen at the beginning of this video. Well, this video is self-consistent, so if you don't know what this algorithm is, don't worry. I will say what it is here. For the rest, there is going to be a paper, a very informal and easy to understand paper, which will say everything about this algorithm, which of course cannot fit in a provisory video such as this. And for more interested viewers, of course, there will be other two papers going more in depth about this subject. Okay. The new features, which are going to be nearly discussed here, fully conclude the heavy theoretical research which was needed to establish this algorithm, and even some extra things have popped up, which of course will be discussed only in the third paper and of course are planned for some future research project. Very fine. Okay, the algorithm has everything so far which I thought it should have. Okay. Of course, to make it more involving and as scarcely academic as possible, he also include, apart from the program itself, which demonstrates and implements the algorithm, of course, also a little flight simulator which allows to fly over the terrain to render, and allows also to land on it, so that people who want to use this for making games or other kinds of programs can have a direct example of such a thing. Very fine. This version of the algorithm uses both my first and second theorem about terrain or surface rendering or approximation. So, the first makes it possible. The second allows to make it fast, allowing to make this algorithm's weight as in terms of numbers of operations that are needed to produce those typical 30 frames per second, but to do it in a way that this number of operations is directly proportional to the total amount of detail displayed. As I'm going to outline it later, this is a very important feature, that this algorithm considers only how much detail is actually displayed in a screen with a limited resolution. In addition to this, I finally figured out also how to read 16-bit color depth grayscale PNG image files, so that now the algorithm can work better and the terrain looks much more natural. Okay. The outline the introduction ends here, but let's say that if you need some information about this algorithm right now, because you are interested or you need it and you can't wait that the first paper comes out, well, you can see the previous video in which, of course, I warned that an experimental version of this algorithm is illustrated in detail. Most of the things hold, of course, for this algorithm, but I warn that at the time that video was made and that experimental version of the program using the algorithm was implemented, I had not yet discovered the second theorem, and I even didn't know that it was possible, of course. So, okay, I just warned you, but you can watch it if you need it so much. Okay, let's go on and outline the main features of this algorithm in a sort of numbered list. Okay, let's go. End of scene. Feature 0. The terrain can be as large as you prefer. No particular limitations on this. A typical size could be a height map made of 16,000 by 16,000 height samples. But it could be much more, of course. Later, we will discuss this a little bit more in depth. Let's just say that basically the idea behind this absence of limits is that this algorithm works fine even when the height map's image can be accessed only in a sort of full streaming fashion. And this works fine even if there are little uncertainties and delays in the access to the pixels of the height map's image. Feature 1. Low computational cost and even lower memory usage, both directly proportional to the amount of detail appearing in the current camera shot. That directly proportional thing is often called linear, and we will discuss this a little bit more later, because it's a very important feature. So, since the algorithm is very light, to say it in a friendlier way, it allows to offer real-time rendering even on low-end, low-cost computers, totally independently of the terrain size. Where by size, I mean how many height samples by how many is made of the height map defining the surface to render. Feature 2. Since, because of perspective, the visible detail tends to decrease indefinitely for regions of the terrain further from the camera, we have unlimited draw distance. This is because the overall amount of detail needed to draw all the terrain tends to a fixed, finite value. In terms of blocks typical of this method, this fixed, limited value is around 6,000 blocks, but also 3,000 do a good job. Feature 3. Very short algorithm, very short source code thus. And it's simple and straightforward conceptually too. This is important because it makes usage simpler, because one can know what is being used, and it's also easier to adapt to special needs in those cases in which there are some. Feature 4. The triangulation scheme typical of this algorithm is the only thing that it inherits from the methods pioneered by Peter Lindstrom and Valerio Pascucci, even if I made a little modification to that scheme in order to make the overall algorithm simpler. All this is discussed in the paper, so let's go on. It required much research to develop this algorithm because it's hard to work well with the triangulation scheme, but instead it's a very versatile. It has lots of interesting properties which can be very useful in a wide range of applications. We will discuss these properties later, but here let's just mention one, that with this algorithm it's possible to render with various levels of approximation of the Turing to render. In this method, this is controlled by a single parameter, whose meaning is very simple. It is how many pixels of screen space difference we allow it to tolerate in the context of the way the algorithm does the approximation. To make a practical example, allowing one single pixel of difference, it provides practically exact rendering. This means that in case we allow only one pixel of screen space difference to be tolerated, all and only those details are displayed which are actually visible from the current camera shot. When this is the case, we also have flawless transitions from less detail to more detail in a given area of the terrain, or vice versa. Feature 5. It's open source and openly documented. This is very important because it's coherent with the original intent of helping those which need a rendering system, or those who are interested in how it all works, or are interested in related things and just want to read and understand about the theory behind real-time rendering of surfaces, or how surfaces can be approximated polygonally. Even one who just likes geography, for example, may find it all very interesting and entertaining. There are plenty of height maps and textures of various geographical areas across the internet, in fact. And these datasets can be visualized in 3D with the system. One more thing, a sort of extra feature, and it is this, that also multi-threading can be exploited to make it faster, yeah, even if this topic is not discussed here, and this feature is not present in the first release, and it is planned to be discussed only in the third paper. However, this is an important feature because not all algorithms can benefit from an implementation which uses multi-threading, let alone benefit equally well from it. Let's just say that for the algorithm discussed here, an enhanced implementation exploiting multi-threading can speed up the thing, so allowing to render always with as few as 1 or 2 pixels of tolerance, thus offering practically flawless transitions of the level of detail as the camera gets closer to or further from a spot while looking more or less in the direction. Some time after the completion of the script of this video, thanks to a friend, it occurred to me that I forgot to mention a very important feature of this algorithm, and it is this. So let us present feature 6. Feature 6 is this. Many people may ask if this algorithm can benefit from limiting the view distance to some reasonable value, and if it makes sense in the context of this algorithm at all, such a thing as limiting the view distance. The answer is yes. The concept is that we allow the addition of detail, that is replacement of a block with its 4 children blocks, only in an area which stays within a certain distance from the virtual camera's ideal center. It's as simple as that, and the answer to the fact whether the answer to the question whether this algorithm can benefit or not from such a limited view distance is yes. Of course, it can benefit a lot, allowing you to have tendentially less detail in one camera shot, and so allowing to use a lower tolerance, often even as low as 1 pixel, and to handle also more easily those, as we call them, bottleneck effects, because the typical tolerance values are 1 and 2, and so even in the most extreme cases it goes up only to 3. And the critical situations tend to be in general less. And one more thing, of course, the view distance can be varied in real time, adding another very useful tool to try to get the best out of the algorithm, such as to obtain a best, tendentially best compromise between draw distance and precision of the rendering, that is a tolerance parameter as low as possible. And well, that was this very important extra feature. So there is a lot of material for the creativity to exploit this algorithm best. Let follow some additional comments here before going on. End of scene. until now, these have been mostly positive details. And of course, there are plenty of them. One can create a really good product by using this algorithm, as long as some creativity is put into how to exploit at best the features. Very fine. Of course, however good an algorithm is for something, it must have also some drawbacks. Very fine. One drawback of this algorithm, about which it's necessary that I warn, is this. According to, well, one negative thing about this algorithm, if an area of a height map sampled from some real geographic area is spotted in which there are those edge lines, but there are many of them, they are tendentially short and they are scattered practically randomly around, these kinds of areas, which of course are areas which accidentally resemble pieces of completely random height map, in these cases the algorithm will be unable to filter, let's say, so any significant edge lines, and will end up by giving a lot of detail, and then the routine which avoids the bottleneck will raise the tolerance. This will reduce significantly the overall detail, and then of course that area made in that area resembling some sort of really random height map or piece of it, of course, will appear very badly. And well, these, okay, in natural geographic areas, and thus height maps sampled from real geographic areas, these situations occur very seldom. But you must know that also, well, of course, one of my favorite data sets is the Puget Sound. And even in that, I found such a region in which the algorithm goes really into problems, and it's very hard to render those areas well. But of course, don't think negative. This was just a warning which was perfectly in place to underline, but the algorithm is very good, as I said, you can do very interesting things with it, very good products, and of course there are many possibilities to maximize the efficiency one can vary in real time, the tolerance parameter one can vary, the view distance in real time, and if an application needs some very critically stable frame rate, by varying these two things, this can be granted fairly easily. With some creativity, I'm sure this algorithm provides lots of things. But, well, of course, miracles don't happen in algorithms, as I don't think any other exact science, whether experimental or theoretical or whatever. So neither here does this happen. Such things as multi-threading and implementation of it, which exploits multi-threading, can give some benefits, but of course it depends on the context, because of course an implementation which tries to exploit multi-threading is significantly more complicated than the original non-multi-threading algorithm, and point number two, it's very hard to implement well an algorithm so that it can exploit multi-threading, and it also takes a lot of time, and it's not necessarily a good idea to go for a multi-threaded variant of the same algorithm, because after all this algorithm does a very specific task. It does the task very well. There are a lot of ways to obtain exactly what one wants from it, and multi-threading may not be a good idea, even because if you are so good with multi-threading, you can put this algorithm, I mean the execution of this algorithm, on one thread, and other tasks of the program you want to do on other threads, and so it's all fine. Okay. 3, 2, 1, end of scene. 3, 2, 1, go. This ends the outline of the features of this algorithm. There are plenty of them to work with. The most important thing in order to get the best results out of the algorithm is to vary in real time the tolerance parameter so as to stabilize the number of blocks around an ideal value, which must be enough high to allow a lot of detail to be given, but a value which is sufficiently lower than the critical value which could cause a slowdown in the frame rate. Of course, here it's perfectly in place to say that since the algorithm is linear, really severe bottleneck effects, which is the typical extreme slowdown of the frame rate, is very hard to obtain. So that's really easy to avoid. And even if it happens, it's not severe. So it's one really doesn't have to worry about. And alternatively, if this is not sufficient, of course, one day there will be the multi-threading version in which you will have as many as like 6,000 blocks, which avoids any need to worry about slowdown, frame rate, varying the tolerance parameter, etc., etc. Very fine. So, let's go on. And discuss more in depth first the concept of full streaming, at which I have hinted at when discussing feature zero. Let's start this discussion by deepening the concept of approximations in the context of this algorithm. We have two things here. First, the fact that the polygonalized approximation of the surface can be more faithful to the original or less faithful to the original in the various areas of it. Second, if we allow some tolerance above one pixel, we also, of course, we have a more brutal approximation tendentially of the surface, but we also have imperfections in the transition from least detail to more detail, or vice versa, in the various areas of the surface. But what we are going to discuss here is that these imperfections are not so severe with this algorithm, and this is a very important feature, because allowing some imperfections sometimes can be a big deal. Let's go on. Okay, according to what we have outlined when discussing the features, This algorithm gives acceptable visual results even when we allow quite a bit of approximation and imperfections, so in the transitions of level of detail. According to what we have outlined when discussing the features, we know that this algorithm gives acceptable visual results even when we allow quite a bit of approximation and thus imperfections in the transitions of level of detail. And this is good. The fact that the algorithm works well anyway is good because we can have a decent rendering even when the data of the height map are accessible only in a sort of full streaming fashion. Let's elaborate on this a bit more. Of course, very large image files, or it could be also a text file or anything, can be accessed only in full streaming, of course. And well, this maybe reminds most of you of something. Images and various compressed multimedial contents as they are being loaded in a web page. Very fine. If so, that's good because I don't have to explain so much. Just think to some PNG format image files as they appear on a website being loaded. Insert example sequence here. End of scene. 3, 2, 1, go. PNG is a heavily compressed file format, and at the same time, it provides lossless compression. All good and nice things, but since we want to take full advantage of the algorithm, we want to access the file in full streaming, so that the algorithm uses approximately as few as 16 megabytes of memory, however large the terrain to render is. Essentially, we have many gigabytes of a height map sitting on the hard disk in form of a single large PNG file. And well, we need to access small portions of that PNG file at a time. PNG allows to do this, but together with the fact that it's also a heavily compressed file format, all this has a price. The price is that it's not as easy to do as reading in full streaming fashion a simple text file, a case in which, for example, the speed of access is deterministic. Well, PNG files can be accessed in a full streaming fashion with deterministic speed of access to its pixels, but we get either an approximated result, either we have to give enough time for it to do the job and get us the exact value of the desired pixel. And well, because of these things I've just tried to say, despite PNG may seem the ideal companion for any terrain rendering system, it is not, because not all rendering systems can work well when there are either approximations in the values of the pixels we get, or delays in the access to these pixels. But our terrain rendering algorithm happens to be very fine even under these circumstances. Because according to what I try to outline a little bit before, this terrain rendering algorithm gives good results even if height samples are sometimes approximated or there are sometimes delays in the access to the height map, making it impossible to transition to a higher level of detail in a certain portion of the surface to render when this would be ideally the case. Well, the algorithm itself is fine, but I also took care of doing some engineering to it in order to allow getting the best out of it. So, three extra features are included in the source code, and they are very useful, even if they stay just in a few lines of code. So let's illustrate them. Point 1. Basically, near the center of the graphical window displaying the application running, we can give less tolerance and give more tolerance in the outer portions. This allows to give a sort of better focus area at the center of the image, which allows to see better, but without wasting all the resources in providing much detail everywhere. This alone would not work well because there would be some quite disturbing graphical glitches near the frontier line between the lower tolerance and higher tolerance areas, especially when turning the camera even only a little. The following 2 points are in fact features which moderate these glitches. So, here is point 2. Essentially, when a block is created, it has an age. At the frame in which it appears the first time, it has age 0. In the following frames, it goes on aging. We can define an age at which we consider it full grown, after which it does not age anymore. This fact of keeping track of a block's age since its creation can be used for many things. This alone is not really useful, but can be very useful if a decent geomorphing is implemented. A topic for which there is absolutely no space in this video. It's essentially a strategy to make the apparel of new detail gradual in time. And finally, there is point 3. It's very simple at this point. A block's removal is not permitted until it has reached the full-grown age which we have conventionally set for it. This feature eliminates most glitches as the camera is turned quietly, causing a sort of strip of area with higher detail to form. This allows to spot greater areas with high detail by gently moving the view center around an area. Let's return to speak about the height map's typical size. It can be any big. In fact, just as a sorting algorithm does not stop at 1,000 names to sort alphabetically, neither does this algorithm stop at a certain height map size. But some care is needed here, because reading big image files is not as immediate. Basically, any big image files can be handled if accessed in full streaming fashion, but this requires to use some really nasty dedicated library like libpng. But the first release of the program is aimed at simplicity of source code, so I used the SDL library in it to read the image file of the height map. But since SDL doesn't really give much control on how to read these files, in the first release we need to stick with 8000 by 8000 files. in which the 16 bits of height samples are arranged, the 8 more significant bits in the red color channel and the other 8 less significant bits in the green channel. I provide also the little utility program which does this conversion, so you can use easily other height maps beside the default one. This is still very good for experimenting, but I just wanted to warn about the difference between capabilities of the algorithm itself and the capabilities of the implementation of it into the first release of source code for computer program. Since I am not a purely theoretical figure, I do also the engineering. So I will release also a version which, relying on libpng to do the full streaming access of the height map image, will allow to use height maps as large as you want, even much larger than 16,000 by 16,000 pixels. Epilogue, a final discussion. This is said to be a view-dependent, dynamic level of detail terrain rendering algorithm, or surface rendering algorithm, whichever you prefer, because of the very way it achieves to distribute variably the detail across the diverse portions of the surface from frame to frame, it literally accumulates detail along sorts of edges which feature on the surface. Such a sort of edge arises where two portions of the surface with different steepness occur side by side. Since the surface to render is typically a terrain, this fact allows to the algorithm to spare with detail more than any other kind of method. This because a terrain typically features very few of those aforementioned edges. And those edges are those naturally arising geographic lines which appear if you look at a photograph of a mountain area lit by direct sunlight and put strong contrast to the photograph and then perform a gradient extraction, or how it is usually called, and obtain an image featuring many lines. One which resembles a hand drawing done with a pencil or a pen. Those are these naturally arising geographic lines. A line occurs where the steepness of the surface locally changes abruptly. If the change is more abrupt, the line is thinner but more stressed, more pronounced. While if steepness changes abruptly but only by a little amount, the line is thin but only weakly stressed. Instead, when steepness changes but not so abruptly, the line is wider, and how much it is stressed depends on how abrupt the change in steepness is. And since we are speaking about a view-dependent surface or terrain rendering algorithm, it's mandatory to mention that the rendering system accumulates more or less detail around these edges, or geographic lines if you prefer calling them so, according to which one and how much is seen from the current camera shot. This is the reason why such a kind of method achieves excellent approximation of a surface with very few triangles, because it arrives at the heart of the way a continuous surface is made. Instead, surface simplification is a topic addressed in another video and is planned to feature among the contents of the third paper about this algorithm. This is also the reason why even quite brutal approximations still allow to, let's say, grasp very clearly the shape of the terrain near the center of the camera shot. Not to mention that the transitions from one distribution of detail to another across the portion of the terrain being spotted by the camera is tendentially smooth, because as detail is added or subtracted, it tends to accumulate or to be removed from edge lines which were already there in the previous frame, making the transition of detail less disturbing because mainly limited to small changes in how well these edge lines are defined, leaving most of the surface intact, as edge lines obviously occupy little area. The method does its duty even when quite some detailed transition glitches are allowed. This is good in some types of applications, not in others, but since usually applications which require to render very large terrains are niche applications, and users of these are tendentially patient, advanced users which tolerate these things and try to exploit the good features at best. And here there are certainly plenty of good features. The features outlined so far make such a kind of method a very advanced surface or terrain rendering algorithm, and this one is, at the same time, also very simple. The friendliness of the method towards naturally shaped terrains makes it very advisable for use in flight simulators, real-time strategy games set in large outdoor environments, planet exploration games or planet visualization programs, off-road vehicle simulation games, and in general those kinds of software packages which need, among other things, to visualize large surfaces. In the source code, I have also put a function which tells the terrain's height locally. This allows to make a video game character stand and walk on the ground, or to a simulated vehicle to go on it, etc. Not to mention trees and buildings to be put on the terrain, and also road networks made of typically curvilinear segments of roads, such as those modeled by the library I wrote for this purpose some time ago, in combination with whom this terrain rendering library can be used, of course. Thank you for watching. Have lots of fun with the rendering algorithm and with the papers discussing it.